talk to you a little bit about scaling impact. So the first little question is, what exactly is scaling? If you go back to a conversation I often have, I say there, normally say there are two things to making an effective impact. There's actually three. The first one is having a solution that works. The second one is having an organization that can deliver it effectively. And the third one, actually, is having a way to reach everybody else that needs it. Yeah, that effectively is scaling. So scaling is essentially the process of impacting more people or factors. The reason why you separate this is because there are two types of scaling. One is what they call in-depth scaling. So you take your program or whatever you're working on, and then you increase the depth of that program. So you cover more factors, which is a slightly less commonly spoken form of scaling. But it's typically something you need to worry about if you want to eradicate problems. The more common one is just getting to more people. Okay. A key distinction that people don't understand is that scaling is not the same as growth. It's often like used as a fancy term for growth, but they're two different things. And the reason is this, that while scaling is often considered as interchangeable, the difference is that growth is when you have an incremental increase in impact or revenue with an equivalently incremental increase in the use of resources. So for example, if it costs you $100 to set up another branch of the work that you're doing, every branch, if it keeps costing you $100, that's growth. Yes? Scaling is different, where you have an exponential increase in impact, or if it was commercial, it would be revenue, with that same incremental increase in resources. So that $100 might now be 100 branches, or if you're really clever about it, you have 100 branches with no additional cost. So why is everyone so excited about scaling? The real reason is that the scale of the problems around the world are very significant. Yeah? And essentially people feel that getting more proven solutions to those people would help us solve and alleviate those issues. That's really what the big discussion globally is about, scaling. And then there are loads and loads of people that are involved in those. And there's a whole other area of people kind of feeling that their impact needs to be at a big scale because it's a good way to show that you've spent your money. So there's a whole other world of why a lot of intermediaries get excited about scaling. But the reality is that we think that scaling is a way to get these well-proven solutions out to a lot of people. So essentially the reality is that because the social sector has limited resources, is the main reason we actually should be excited about it. As compared to growth, where we don't have the resources to just keep increasing our reach by pumping loads and loads of money at things, you've got to think about scaling, which is that for limited resources, you get an exponential increase in your impact. And the rest of this presentation really is going to be about the fact that organic growth, which is an increase in size of your organization. There are a number of different ways you can do that, but essentially it's not the same as scaling, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. What's the big risk, really, in this? Is that you can, if you scale badly, have a significant dilution of impact. That's like the first major risk. Yeah, so what typically happens is that, depending on all the work that you're doing, some components of it are easy to scale, and in the drive to scale and reach more people, what can happen is you just start focusing on those little pieces without recognizing that that piece alone doesn't solve the problem. Yeah? The second is that you have significant organizational pain. And the reason, you know, it goes from financial pain to the fact that the teams and founders get distracted, and the fact that the local operations aren't exactly robust before they start doing international or regional operations. So you end up with these significant organizational challenges and pains when people scale if they don't scale up well. There's also a lot of well-accepted myths and misunderstandings which further complicate the ability of organizations to scale. Some classic ones are that, like I mentioned before, scaling is a fancy word for growth. Scaling is typically linear. This is the idea that, you know, it'll kind of walk, you'll keep going along the linear path, but it's not like that. It's typically a step-by-step exercise. So you're going to have a jump, then you need to consolidate, think about it, restructure, jump again, think about it, consolidate, restructure. If you don't understand that, all that happens is that the reality forces you to kind of take a few steps back. And that's what typically happens. Organizations scale very fast. We're a living example as an organization that, you know, at one point we were 90, 100 shelters, and now we're down to 67, 70 shelters, simply because it was unmanageable at that size. Now, again, when we grow, it'll be because we paused. We've been at 67 shelters for a whole, about 3 years now, 70, 67 shelters, and before we then doubled up in size. Yeah? Another common misunderstanding is the fact that impact scaling and commercial scaling are the same things. They're basically not. And the reason for that is that commercial scaling is about more money. Yep. Social scaling, so dream is explosive financial growth. The other reason why companies want to scale is that there's huge profits involved in it. Now for us it's different, it's about better outcomes. It's essentially about a world without hardships. So the goals are completely different, which means the approaches need to be different. The fact, however, is that there are some commonalities between the two, yeah? Which is that in both cases, you'll first have sort of like a horizontal growth within an organization, then a verticalization inside organizations, and then eventually you look at kind of a horizontal growth inside the problem space or the market, and then a verticalization inside that market, okay? Which is essentially when you start going towards how to solve those problems instead of just reaching more problems, reaching more people. We'll go back to that. So the key thing then is that the different approach bit comes a bit later because the divergence occurs at the point of the end goal. Yeah? So the final scaling of one is essentially to solve problems altogether, when the final goal for the others is dominating a market space. So if you don't realize that these two things have different approaches, which is why in one case proprietary ownership is critical. And what happens is because people think it's the same for both, there's an attempt to hold proprietary ownership also for impact. And that's actually one of the big limiting factors in how people scale. So going to how do you scale? The reality is that there are a lot of simple impact models. Yeah? Example would be if you're selling a solar lamp, for example. Yeah? But there are a number of things where it's a simple product, it's a one-dimensional, it's a package service, it's a workshop, it's a school, it's something that can actually be packaged and moved along. You can do these with a lot of different traditional approaches. And traditional approaches would be things like these. Organic growth, which I mentioned before, is just you get more resources, you get more team members, you get more branches, you become a bigger organization, you just keep growing in size. You can franchise out, which is what I'm going to now, but franchising, acquisitions, and mergers are your typical standard organizational kind of company type growth. Things in the social space, you don't see too many of these, but you definitely see these. Yeah? Or people attempt to aspire towards these things because they think that's the only way to go. And like I said, unfortunately people think this is the way for all organizations, which is one of the challenges. The reality is one size doesn't fit all because there are lots of different types of social organizations. And this is a basic sketch, but you can see that there are these what are single point impact organizations that have standalone products or technologies, or they have package services that can just stand alone by themselves, and they will typically have one point of impact, a mosquito net, for example. Yeah? On the other hand, you have things like what we call piece of the puzzle projects. And these will be, for example, if you specialize in life skills, or you specialize in education, but your goal is child outcomes. The reality is that there's a whole other set of impact interventions that have to work together to result in that. And then finally, you have fully transformative, holistic solutions like Make a Difference. Yeah? So now when you get into this space, it's much harder to scale. Yeah? It's much harder to scale because you can't afford to have the dilution of impact. And because as you get bigger and bigger, the organizational pains just increase because the complexities are high. Yeah? So one of the main things that's worth recognizing for yourself, you know, for people that are trying to scale is where do you fall in as an entity? So one of the key things that people struggle with at that stage is these three pieces, which is skill or capacity gaps, CEO funder dependencies, and raising necessary investment. These are three major, major challenges that social impact organizations face when trying to get it to scale. The challenge, of course, is, or the reality is, they still attempt it, but they learn all this the hard way post attempting it. And one of the reasons for that is that it's quite rare that organizations strategically choose to scale. It's very often that other players come in and then push them to scale because somebody else has an agenda or has a demand that they want an organization to meet. So the key thing is, if you want to do this successfully, we have to start thinking differently. The main thing that I recommend to all organizations is the social space, is to recognize that your impact model has to be seen as separately scalable from the organization itself. Now that proprietary ownership that basically says this is our model means people often imagine that for your thing to scale, your organization must scale with it. And the replication, something like transition times, which we'll cover a bit later, they will have proved the model, they will have developed it, created a mature version of it, and then made its entire replicability completely free and open. Now there are a whole host of them, but essentially they've separated the methodology from their entity. there's an evolution component, again, which I'll talk about in a bit. You might have to evolve to help other players implement that model in a good way, but essentially those things have to be seen as that. Commercial organizations fundamentally don't do this. So, how else can you scale? Going along that line, piggybacking is one of the key ways that we do that. Is essentially leveraging the scale of others. So either you can scale through government, or you can scale through policy and changing regulation, you can scale through hybrid value chains, you can scale through using partnerships with businesses. A good example is something like Cimientos in Argentina. They've built their scholarship model, and now they've convinced the Argentinian state to replicate that across 500,000 scholarships. Yep. So they're basically piggybacking. It's very simple. What we're going to do here is we're going to piggyback off the scale of the existing shelter system, rather than run a whole host of shelters ourselves in order to reach children. Okay. And next, one of the important recognitions is the concept of evolution rather than growth. As you move through, as you scale, the nature of that scaling essentially means that you have a different focus as an entity, and you have to evolve into that space. If, for example, policy change is one of them, you will need a policy change team. You'll have to shift your resources and your focus from being a delivering entity to a policy enabler, and then eventually a policy rollout enabler and an accountability body. So the whole entity has to look at how it evolves up that curve, rather than think that it'll just grow in size along its existing team set. The second way you can look at this is dispersal, which is essentially seeding the model and facilitating the spread. That's why the transition towns are a good example, which is CD, which is basically scaling through transferability. 826 National, I don't know if you've heard of Dave Eggers, is like a famous pioneer in the education space. If you haven't heard of it, worth a look. But essentially, he pioneered this kind of like child-focused education environment, and now lots of people around the world are replicating it, and they built a foundation that supports that replication, but essentially they don't have any ownership. And the ideation at the point of replication is unique to the players that decide to implement it. Yeah? Another example, of course, is scaling to micro-franchising, things like Vision Springs, Business in a Bag, a bit like an Avon model where you have a local seller that then sells those products, and then there's a profit margin for them, and they'll use things like if it's products for babies or nutrition products and so on and so forth. In this case, I think it's glasses. You have to evolve to manage spread of distribution. So again, there's an evolution component for each of these, because the impact, the implication is to ensure the reusable systematization of what you do. Okay. Finally, your third thing you can look is movement. A lot of change and impact is run through movements. Yeah, and there are different ways that you can run those movements. You can scale through brand, but essentially looking at changing mass behavior, cultural behavior, scaling through mass participation, scaling through cooperation. Something like Movimento São Paulo in Brazil, 600 nonprofits have basically come together to create a coalition that lobbies against government for the outcomes that they want. And again, the key thing here is you have to become a kind of logistical support agent. At some point, if we decide that we're going to enable movements, people coming up against the state, you have to enable the logistics of their coming together. Whether it's online, whether it's offline, there's a whole evolution for you. So now, all of these things have an implication that you've understood what the methodology is, but now you're looking at the mechanism of that methodology being transferred through different ways, not just your typical organic growth type. And the final one that we'll talk about is open standards, which is essentially leveraging open standards and interactions with funding, design, development, delivery. Crowdfunding is a good example of this. Scaling through open source. Ushahidi, if you haven't heard of it, uses open standards and collaborative networks for sourcing development, leverage the power of crowds for delivering change. Other things like open design for drugs. The Thai government has basically made all drug designs open. So it's one of the big challenges you have everywhere. Cipla has a lot of generic drugs that developing world countries can replicate at low cost, because that's one of the big kind of pharmaceutical destructions of the world today, which is on a poverty level, and they don't make their drugs and things available for people on the healthcare. And then finally, in this case, you need to evolve to provide advisory support and build those platforms for continuous improvement. So that's how people come together, researchers, scientists, coders, how do they get together, collaborate, and move the thing forward. Then finally, The reality of it is that there's a lot of this conversation about scaling pathways, and there's actually more than these, and they get listed out in different ways. But the main thing that people need to understand is that it's, you don't just use one. You actually have to use a combination of these. If you look at something like us, we use all of them. Yeah, we basically have piggybacking, we've got dispersal, we've got open standards, we've got movement, because we make our stuff shareable for other people. We're building movement of people across the country to lobby against government, to drive change at a social level. There's a whole bunch of stigmas that need to be dealt with, to be movement related. Then piggybacking is how do we work with the shelter systems, how do we eventually work with schooling systems, how do we eventually work with parental systems. Yeah, so all of these things are, you know, when we look at dispersal, is essentially how do we then, when we look at scaling, none of our scaling mechanisms are really built on us growing. And if you look at even our own roadmaps, in the middle is essentially what we evolve into, right? So each of these stages has an evolution expectation. So we know how the organization has to develop across its time frame to enable that scaling. One of the factors that derail scaling, I'll go through this pretty quickly. The key thing is it's not a simple exercise. People, there's a lot of this idea, because we're trying to get you to go in and scale, a lot of intermediaries will make people feel like it's an easy enough exercise. You're making good impact, your organization looks good, yep, scaling will be fine. Scaling will not be fine. there are five main reasons why people struggle, or organizations struggle with scaling: an unclear purpose, which essentially leads to failures in design and decision making, inapplicable design, which limits the flexibilities needed to address needs of new environments, non-systematic approaches to set up and implementation, which limits replicability, inflexible organizational design, lack of operational readiness, which limits the ability to deliver at scale, and finally, poor implementation planning. So you have inadequate cost modeling, and that means you basically can't raise the actual finance you need to be able to do to reach the scale that you need, okay? And then, can you beat these? Yes, you can. Ask yourself five questions. Question one, is your purpose clear and well-defined? Because we're time limited, I won't go into the details of this, but essentially, this goes back to a point I made earlier, is that a lot of times, scaling is not a strategic activity. It's not a case of doing a benchmark that says, what is the true scale of the need or the problem that you're dealing with? And how do we address that, which is a lot like our design, which is then reverse engineered backwards. But it's much more a case of third parties coming in and then encouraging you to scale. There's money available, there are opportunities, there's a partnership that comes to the table, let's do this. And it makes your organization look better, allows you to raise more money. So there's a number of these reasons that people go into scaling, but it's not very often strategically related to impact or impacting the true numbers of individuals that need or communities that need that support. Is your design applicable at scale? The reality is that the thing that you do at a local level doesn't necessarily apply at a national or global level. And this is because scaling, your organization has two components. It has a methodology, which will probably apply, but it has a delivery mechanism that is separate from that methodology. And this is typically badly understood in the sector discourse. So what will happen is that you'll have a mechanism for how you deliver impact. For example, in our case, we've got volunteers. If we wanted to reach 30 million children, would we be in a scenario where we can find 60 million volunteers? The answer to that is no. So the delivery mechanism is not going to work the same way. So we have to figure out how to then redesign the delivery mechanism to reach a demographic of 30 million children. So there's a significant redesign component that is required at each stage as you shift up that curve. The third question essentially is, your model systematized and transferable? If your model isn't transferable, nobody else is going to be able to replicate it. You will not be able to separate your model of viable change from the organization itself. You will literally have to grow with the size, with the increase in reach, to make sure that it gets delivered the way it should. Because third parties essentially won't be able to do anything with the stuff that you produce. Fourth one, is your organization ready to scale? Really is, this is very rare. Few organizations get themselves ready and then scale, because the platforms required to be ready are fairly complex, from the skills required to the internal dependencies, to the founder, to the whole kind of single agent making all the decisions exercise, to the technology not being scalable. And then of course it's the whole resistance to change, which is your entity even bought into that change before you go off, and maybe the key decision makers are, nobody else is, you're going to end up with sabotage. So organization readiness is a key indicator of whether or not that scaling will eventually work. And then the final question is, your implementation planning robust? If you don't get your planning right, further down the line, it's very costly to change or adjust. Now, planning is a complex exercise, and people don't realize that for scaling, there are many, many streams. It's kind of a multilinear exercise. And some of the streams, for example, are getting all your strategy right, getting your finance and fundraising right, getting all your logistics in place, the human resources, etc. Technology, all the computing, is it scalable? Communications, internal and external, your impact monitoring, and quality control. And then, of course, if you go partnerships, you would worry about all the handovers, the partnership management, etc. Okay? So I call this the PATRI framework. Yeah? P, purpose, applicability, transferability, readiness, implementation. And I've built a detailed step-by-step guide that you can find online. Just Google the PATRI framework, and you'll be able to access the guide of how you would implement along those five lines. And then in summary, scaling is a process of impacting more people or factors. It's not the same as growth. Everyone's excited because resources are limited and problems are urgent. Key to scaling is to ensure your model of viable change is separated from your organization itself. Getting it wrong essentially risks dilution of impact and significant organizational pain. Very messy. One size doesn't fit all, so we need to start thinking differently. Five core drivers of failure, like we discussed, you can manage these using the PATRI framework.